Excellent. So we're going to go ahead and call this meeting of the Economic and Community Development Committee to order. Today is December 5th. And so today, the topic on the agenda, we have MSD, many representatives from MSD here today that are, we have two that are going to present to talk about the status of flood claims. And if we have time today, also talk about the Norwood sewer system. So I'd like to invite, I guess, the representatives from MSD to introduce themselves. And if you could let us know who else is here too in the audience as well from MSD, I'd love to know who everybody is. So
I'm Pat Arnett. I'm chief engineer in the engineering division, and we've got why don't you go ahead and introduce yourselves. Deb.
Deb Leonard. Cassandra Hillary, community outreach.
Excellent.
Don Jackson, communications.
Debbie Arcon,
engineering.
Oh, sorry, Vicki. Thanks.
And I am Mike Pittenger. I'm the wastewater collection superintendent for the Metropolitan Sewer District.
Great. Excellent. Well, I just want to thank all of you all for being here. I very much appreciate it. And thanks to the residents that are here as well. So, Mike, I'll just let you, if you'd like, just to go ahead and begin the presentation that you all have laid out. And just so everybody knows, too, we're going to try to cut this off at 7 o'clock. So if we do have things that go past 7, then we'll work on just arranging a second meeting, possibly in January. So, but excellent. Well, hopefully, we don't need that, but if we do, we'll go before that. So, Mike, yeah, feel free.
Yeah, so again, thanks for having us here for this evening. I think in talking to James ahead of time about this, we tried to understand as much as possible about what type of material you might be interested in going over this evening. And he brought up a fairly extensive laundry list of things. So that's why I preface that to say, you know, we honed in on a few items, and I think we may have the order different than you just talked about, but hopefully that's not a problem.
It'll be fine.
But again, some of this stuff is very high level. We could go on for a long, long time on a lot of things, and I think it's probably a lot more than anybody in here would want to do. But again, we'll be happy to come back as many times as you'd like. So with that being said, the agenda that we had planned after talking to James a little bit was talk about a very high level overview of the sewer system in Norwood. Pat's here to help answer other questions if you have, you know, other detailed questions about design standards or permitting, any of those type of things, or we can table that to a part two if you'd like. So I'm going to talk about it, you know, from very much a high level there. Number two, we're going to talk about specifically what happened on the 28th and a little bit of what didn't happen, because as we all know, these, you know, it was a very, very traumatic event. We understand that for a lot of people. It's a natural occurrence that, you know, we've seen this for many, many, many years. People sometimes jump to conclusions about what happened, and they connect some dots that may not actually be real dots to connect, but we understand why they do. So we want to take the time, if you have any specific questions about those, or again, we can come back if there, you continue to hear different things and address them directly. So the third item that we would do is talk about just an overview of what the claims process actually is. It is certainly morphed from day one of this process, and we'll be the first one to admit this because we're in sort of uncharted territories here. So it has morphed. We'll talk about what the process is right now and give you some stats of where we are currently. And again, answer questions that you may have on it. And again, it's sort of the underlying current on this thing. It's an open offer for us to come back as frequently or as infrequently as you would prefer if you have to look at the two of us. So with that, let's move forward. Feel free to interrupt me at any time. If you have any questions or you'd like me to expand or Pat to go into more detail. So as basic as this is, there's some method to the madness here, and it's really sort of important for everybody to understand. There's really two primary types of sewer systems. There are separated sewers and there's combined sewers. So separated sewers, just like the picture on the left shows, typically you're going to find two distinct pipes that'll be out in the street or in an easement or wherever the drainage sort of takes it. One is going to be the separate sanitary sewer. Typically, that's deeper in the ground because it's trying to provide service to basements and lower levels on there just through gravity without any pumps. And typically, you'll have a much larger pipe that is the storm sewer, which in the picture on the left, that would be the upper pipe there. And you can see that there's an inlet from the street actually connected straight to it. On the right, we have a combined sewer. As the name would suggest, it is combined. It takes both sanitary flow from the houses, the fixtures, toilets, sinks, plus all the storm water, which includes the storm water not only from the street runoff, but also from downspouts and other areas. The interesting part we have here is most areas have pretty much one or the other. Norwood is a bit different. Norwood has both. And there are places that are distinctly combined sewers. There are places that are nominally separate sewers where you'll find a nominal sanitary sewer and a storm sewer owned by Norwood. One important thing to remember is this graphic tries to convey, based on just the geographic location of Norwood and where everything goes, they all ultimately flow to combined sewers. And it goes in different ways, and we'll talk about that a little bit more. But it's important to understand this concept, and it's also, Norwood is unique, and it's just the reality of the situation. Even in where there are separate sewers, it's not uncommon for us to find that there are taps that go to the wrong sewer. And they've been like that probably since day one where they were installed. And it's really only at this point where we have better technology to be able to investigate sewers more internally that we can identify more of those things. But Norwood is unique. There's no doubt about that. But it ultimately all does flow to combined sewers. So, as the satellite flies, here's sort of a satellite view of the Norwood city limits. Now this first picture here shows you in the cyan, off to the right, approximately, running up Montgomery Road. It's interesting, and it's not uncommon for an old road like this, but it followed a ridge. So it was a high point. So essentially everything to the east of Montgomery Road flows into what's known as the Upper Duck Creek Basin. You can see the little label on there, and you can see that the Duck Creek Basin upper extends beyond to the south, the political jurisdiction of Norwood, and it also extends to the north and to the east. Water knows no political jurisdictions. So this is essentially covering the area. If it rains in something, where's it going to go? On the surface. So these are what we would call a watershed, because it's primarily the overland water flow. And that can be different from some other pieces we'll talk about. So on the west side of Norwood, approximately, you have the Ross Run watershed. Again, the portion of Norwood is part of that. It is not all of it. And that actually goes ultimately to what was originally the Ross Run watershed, which goes into the Mill Creek. On the east side, we're going over into the Duck Creek, heading the opposite direction. And if two wasn't enough, we have a third. Up at the top. This is ultimately tributary to the Mill Creek as well, but it doesn't go to the same place. It ends up going flowing up to the north and ultimately through Elmwood Place before it discharges into the Mill Creek. This is the Bloody Run watershed. And you can see again, the Bloody Run watershed extends significantly to the north. It just so happens that this portion in Norwood is the very southern end of it there. So, if that wasn't enough, we have watersheds where water sort of, if it hits the ground, would tend to want to go naturally, but we also have sewer sheds. So the other part that you see in here with this overlay is sort of the pale lines, the cream lines, are sewer sheds. So if we were actually looking at where all the sewers collect and flow, we're going to be looking at these. Sewers act primarily as kind of like, they're almost like a vein system in your body. You know, they start very, very small at the extremities, and they get increasingly larger until they get back to their final destination. And they branch just like that. So the sewers may actually sometimes cross the watersheds because drainage, some of the sanitary flow in one area, may actually go the other way against the natural lay of the land. So it gets complicated, particularly when you're talking about some of this sort of hybrid of systems that exist in Norwood. So here's the same overview here. You see the three primary watershed components within the city of Norwood limits, and you can see the broader pieces here. Now, what we have superimposed on here are the MSD main sewers. Those are all the green lines that you see. So across the entire district in there, there's give or take about 90,000 main sewer segments, which makes up about 3,000 miles of main sewer. So again, water and sewage knows no political boundaries. So as you can see on here, it's just like with that sort of arterial analysis. You know, everything comes and it collects from the smaller and it gets bigger and bigger. And you'll other see there's a bunch of other little labels popped up on here. Those are CSOs. So for those of you who've been paying attention to a lot of the materials that come out from our communication department on here, you know that CSOs are a major concern for MSD and they're a major driver for its consent decree. And that is based in federal EPA policy and CSO rules on there. So one of the prime drivers on here is MSD needs to greatly reduce CSOs. CSOs are combined sewer overflows. They're physical structures that were designed as you collected more and more of that designed or collected combined sewer flow. It gets into bigger and bigger sewers until ultimately, closer to the end, when you get close to a body of water, typically there's an interception point. There's a smaller diameter sewer that takes it in normal dry weather when it's not raining and takes it through a separate pipeline and takes it to one of our treatment plants. So that's what it works. That's how it works most days. When it's raining, the capacity of those smaller diameters to intercept the flow to the treatment plant is overwhelmed, and these CSOs overflow, hence the name, the combined sewer overflows. So the volume of that then goes into a natural body of water. That is exactly what they were designed to do from day one. At the time when they were actually built first like this, this was considered best practice and the best thing to do environmentally because it took things away and put it into a stream where it could be diluted and taken away. We didn't worry so much about who was getting it downstream or anything like that. So a big focus of MSD's consent decree are capital projects to greatly reduce the volume coming out of those CSOs. Well, why does that matter? Well, it matters a lot for incidents like this because we can find ourselves at cross purposes. The natural inclination when you have a backup is to just make bigger pipes. Take it away from the areas that are backing up. And on some level, that makes perfect sense. And frankly, if I were a customer or a homeowner in an area that experienced backups and heavy rain, I would probably feel exactly the same way. The problem with that is that would put a lot more flow at the same points that are overflowing. Not to mention you'd have to upsize every single pipe in between to increase that capacity, which very quickly would get to where it is not financially possible. You know, our rates would not support it and people would not be willing to pay that much money and couldn't pay that much. So we're in a difficult bind here in what we're trying to do. So where do these actually go in some of the sides? Well, again, it's sort of roughly the east, roughly, of Montgomery Road. There's two primary CSOs that are very actually right at the border of the Norwood municipal line. So you have CSO 170, which is the Norwood incinerator, which is if you went past the waterworks and down there into sort of public services area, Public Works Department of Norwood, it's down in there. Most people would not know it's there. Further to the south on there, you have CSO 549, which is the Williams Avenue and Duck Creek Road CSO. These are very large, and I'll show you a little bit later on. Most of the time, when these combined sewers started in a local neighborhood, sometimes in an older neighborhood as small as 8 inches in diameter, by the time they join with all the other sewers and discharge at one of these CSOs, you will find a pipe that is 20 feet wide and 14 to 16 feet high. So easily, because this whole area here. So it's a substantial amount of water, and they're discharging into these waterways. In some cases, they are the waterway. There is no natural creek that they're discharging into. Where they discharge is the start of a drainage path. Off to the west, you can see where that flow ultimately goes. CSO 485 is the Ross Run RTC, which stands for Real Time Control. This is a newer facility that was installed at an existing CSO. So again, very, very large pipes. If you look in the lower left here, you'll see sort of the discharge. It looks kind of small here, but again, that's very, very large. It discharges directly through the channelized portion of the Mill Creek wall. It's down sort of the PNG area there, right along Mill Creek. The real-time control facility is designed in there in small rain events to be able, there's an inflatable dam close to the outfall on there, and it's designed to measure the flow in the sewers and inflate and store water back into the combined sewer and not let it overflow in small events so more flow can get to the treatment plant. In extreme wet weather events where there's a lot of flow in there, the dam deflates automatically and water will absolutely pour out of this. And this is where, you know, I think a lot of people have, there's been multiple theories about some of this stuff, that there was a failure in this facility and that it backed up the entire system upstream of it. We can show you very clearly that that's not the case on there. There's a, as you'd expect, there's a lot of sensors and there's a lot of data on this because there's a lot of programmable logic controllers associated with this. So there was no backup from this facility. The Mill Creek was not elevated because of where the rain was. It wasn't restricted in any water coming out of here. So that wasn't the source of the backup. Now let me go back one more. Just one little thing I forgot to point out. Again, it's important to note on here, if you look at this, just the proximity, and you can see sort of the yellow line. That is pretty much the center line of that main trunk sewer as it leaves that sort of western combined sewer area of Norwood. So it sort of snakes along there and ultimately gets over there. So it's right at the Mill Creek before it discharges. But it obviously takes a lot of other flow from other municipalities before it discharges there as well. And these were some of the same municipalities and CNAS areas in the city of Cincinnati that experienced very, very heavy flow the same night.
But that, on the 28th, that did not overflow. The Mill Creek did not overflow.
It did.
It did, okay.
Yes, absolutely. It absolutely was flowing very heavy, but the dam was not inflated to try and hold anything back in there because of the volume that was going on in the pipes.
And you're saying that the water level in Mill Creek did not go over the outlet there?
That's correct.
At Ross Run? Okay.
Yeah. Up to the north again, we have the individual area going to the Bloody Run. CSO, so that's CSO 181, Bloody Run. And again, here's a picture of one of those, so you can see sort of the, again, larger than a two-car garage door, essentially, that's on there, and that's a over 20-foot wide sewer behind their combined trunk that this ultimately discharges to. So you can see the path in the sort of light blue up at the north that this takes from this area before it ultimately discharges into this. This is the perfect example of what I talked about before. It's not discharging straight into Mill Creek. That is the beginning of the Bloody Run Creek. So in dry weather, there's absolutely no flow in that creek whatsoever. There used to be, obviously, years and years and years ago before all this stuff was piped in. But in a normal day, nothing. when it's raining upstream and in one or more of these areas, and it doesn't have to be all of them because the rain's very isolated, you will very much see that door open, just like a flip garage door, and suddenly there's a lot of flow in there. That ultimately, through a relatively short path, will go and discharge directly into the Mill Creek.
How does that door open? Is it automatic? Like, does the water push it open, or is there something that lifts it up?
Yeah, there's no mechanical actuators on it or anything like that. It's just, most of these flaps are designed so that they're balanced, so that very little pressure on them will just open it.
Gotcha.
Which is actually always kind of fun if you're with new employees on some of these tide gates, because you can act like you can really pull these things open. For a scrawny guy like me, that's hours of endless fun. So.
Awesome, thank you.
So, what happened on the 28th? Well, and I'm not trying to be trite here, you know, I'm not. The reality is it rained really, really hard. You know, and I'm not trying to minimize that in any sense, but it rained harder than the sewers were able to convey. And the reality is when you know when it rained, it wasn't a typical Cincinnati thunderstorm that moved across the county and kept going right. It popped up, it blossomed, and it sat there. It sat there stationary for about 2 hours and barely moved until it had had its fill, and that was it. But it was 2 hours. What's that actually look like on the data? And you know, James was sort of telling me the other day that we must coach people well on this because everybody has the same party line. It was based in the actual data. If you look at the sort of rain radar that's on here, so again, Norwood is sort of shown in the yellow highlighted area, and you can see the rainfall distribution on there from our rain radar. So what this is actually where we have discrete rain gauges. We can't have gauges everywhere. So we have gauges that are spread about largely in communities, and then we calibrate it against what falls in those actual rain gauges to the radar. It's highly pixelated in there from the National Weather Service. So it goes through a lot of mathematical processing and sort of comes out with the total rainfall. This one was kind of interesting because a lot of the gauges were actually closer to the perimeter of this sort of thing. So this was actually a very interesting case of why rain radar can be very useful, because you can't have a gauge everywhere that you can monitor. So what do you have? Well, down there in the lower left, you see actually on here, this is approximately one of the grids close here to Norwood, which was frankly right at one of the peaks in the overall grid. So in this particular one, there was close to 5.5 inches in less than 2 hours. The sewers are not designed to carry that much water, even if it could get into them, which frankly it can't. It'll overwhelm inlets at that point. So what do we have? Well, in areas where there are separate sewers, and there are areas like that in Norwood, there are Norwood-owned storm sewers. Those storm sewers were overwhelmed. They were not designed or built or sized to carry the amount of rain that fell that night. In the areas with combined sewers, they were absolutely overwhelmed almost across, I think it's safe to say, across the entire municipal boundary of Norwood, as you can see from the rain that fell. No combined sewers that exist in Norwood are sized to carry that much water. And we all know that many properties flooded, some with sewer backups, some exclusively with overland flooding, and some with both. And it gets really difficult at that point to see exactly where the water all came from. It's kind of a fool's errand to try in most of the stuff. So bottom line, what happened? Well, because of the elevations and because of what we know, what was going through some of those trunk sewers and the levels of the creeks that they ultimately discharged to, the system didn't back up from those creeks and back up into the local sewer systems. That's not what happened. The local sewer systems did not have the capacity to capture and convey all the water that actually fell on them. And so a combination of backups from being completely pressurized and overland flow that couldn't even get into the pipes flooded the properties. And it really is as simple as that. We have found some places where discrete things, where, you know, isolated problems with sewers. In this particular area, we haven't found anything where there was any sort of massive failure or anything like that. It still gets widely reported, but it's not true. So, we could go into lots and lots and lots of details on this stuff, but that's probably more than you ever wanted to know anyway on this stuff. But do you have any questions just about in general about the sewer systems?
Yeah, actually, that was about what I wanted to know. So it was definitely not more. That was great. I've been very curious about where our water goes since, you know, this incident. So that was helpful. So you mentioned that, I do have a question about the last comment that you just made about the local sewers mm-hmm. being overwhelmed. So what would happen if one of these, you know, at some point you said these things could be up to 20 feet wide, 14 feet tall, I think maybe you said. What would happen though if at that point that was overwhelmed? Where would the water go at that point? Would it go back into the local sewers?
It will, and this is to a degree. And this is where you have to actually look at some of the elevations on these. And you know, this is where we do a lot of hydraulic modeling on there to actually look at these pieces. But if you look at the actual elevations, the difference, although it seems like there's very little, if you actually look at this from where we are to where you would be at one of those creeks, there can easily be, you know, 40 to 50 feet of fall in between. So what tends to happen is if there's a backwater condition, at the, you know, say it was, the creek was flooded, and this, we've had this before, certainly. Say it rained really, really hard in Butler County and northern Hamilton County. So the Mill Creek is running very, very full. Maybe it's getting up all the way. You know, they size those things when the core channelizes those to be able to convey a 100-year flood as opposed to 100-year rain. So it'll still probably be contained in there, but the outfall of some of those CSOs may be submerged. So if you look at hydraulically what'll happen on there, in most cases, there'll be a backwater effect into the system. At some point, and particularly in combined sewers, where a lot of the lids, there's a lot of inlets, there's a lot of lids that are not bolted down, it starts blowing out those. And so before you would see backups from a way downstream effect like that, you're going to see a lot of those geysers and blowouts downstream on there. It could have a residual effect far upstream, but it would have to be just the right circumstances, and typically that's, it just doesn't happen like that. It's certainly not the case of what happened here.
And so you have data to show that in the more main area, especially with the Ross Run, because it has the real-time control in it,
yeah.
You actually have data to show that the pipes going, you know, let's just say, you know, in the St. Bernard area or maybe in the Cincinnati area along Tennessee Avenue, you have data to show that some of those pipes were not completely full. Is that
correct?
At no time they were, those pipes going down Ross Avenue or Tennessee Avenue, you're saying at no time those were so full that it would have slowed down the water coming from the local sewers?
I can't say, you know, categorically on everything, because there's, again, there's a lot of sewer segments and there's individual sections or anything. But what we do know, because I actually checked this like immediately after this event, we want to know if there was some sort of failure at that facility. That's the only one that actually has a facility at this point with any sort of control. The other two, it's essentially free outfall. So we wanted to check right away. So we checked with our watershed operations group on there, and they monitor those facilities very closely because that's what they do. And they report on overall volume control for some of those CSOs. And they confirmed that essentially there was no backwater effect from those at that point.
Just a follow up on that. So at the openings, at the CSO openings, those at no time were completely full for the backup to come back to St. Bernard, Norwood, what have you. It's just that the pipes underground here were not large enough to take the amount of water that was coming down to discharge it into those CSOs. The CSOs would have been able to handle if there were larger pipes, potentially, but...
I don't know. That's one of those theoretical questions, you know. If everything was upsized dramatically here, would that, those outfalls have been enough? I don't know. But the reality is they never got there.
So the understanding is that the amount of water going down into the ground here and around here was far more than the diameter of the pipes could take it away. They just couldn't take it away fast enough. And that's why we would see it coming up through the sewer lids and the, you know, because of it just had nowhere else to go.
That's absolutely correct.
Yep.
So what percentage of, do you know what percent, like about what percentage of our Norwood sewers are combined and what percentage have separated, even though, again, those, they go to the same place and those separated ones sometimes have the wrong connections, but do you know what percentage?
I don't know off the top of my head. I mean, as a ballpark, I feel very much ballpark. I think there's a, I think it's somewhere probably about 2/3 are combined, but we can actually run the numbers on that and get back to you more specifically if you'd like.
Yeah, thank you. That'd be great. And then just for comparison, I'd love to get the city of Cincinnati and just to find out what theirs are.
The city of Cincinnati is actually different. There's very few separate sewers in the city, almost. I wouldn't say all, but they
small percentage.
Yeah, a much higher percentage of the sewers in the city of Cincinnati are combined.
Interesting. What do you know why that was? At the
it's just the way it's an older, you know, it was an older area. Why the interesting part to me is because of the age of Norwood, it's relatively unusual to see separate sewers. So why some of them were built that way around here originally, it's hard to say. It would have been more normal to make them all combined.
So it's just cheaper to put in one system as opposed to two. Which is why the city, and back then that was the preferred technology, you know, a combined sewer.
And Mayor Williams, did you want to?
Yeah, the 1968 when MSD was formed and was planned, Cincinnati was probably at the head of the whole thing. And Cincinnati was running the operation. And Cincinnati was classified as all-com combination. And Norwood didn't get classified that way. Cincinnati basically said, no, ours is all combination. Norwood, for whatever reason, wasn't smart enough to say, so is ours, because they all empty into the same place. Every one of them empty into the same place. So basically what happened was, Norwood got the short end of the stick in 1968, and I'm sure you weren't responsible for that. But we'll check in.
Thank you. I may have shaken my rattle at the 68.
So that's what happened. And to this day, most of the time, you know, you're talking about CSO down on Duck Creek Road. That has been built up and restricts the flow of that water, because what's coming out of there when it rains is raw sewerage. So it all empties into the same spot. So really, as far as I'm concerned, MSD should have taken all our sewers to this day, because you will never solve that unless you take all those sewers, because it all goes to the same spot. I think it was a way for Cincinnati to say, no, MSD takes over everything from us, and Norwood didn't have that luxury. This last flood, I agree, I don't think there's anything anybody could have done. I mean, it was massive. If you'd have gone down and looked at the flow out of that pipe or a thunderstorm, to be quite frank, when you see brush and trees and everything with toilet paper in there, there's a clue. So, you know, and that goes on, and that flows into that main sewer system that runs under 71, which comes down from Fairfax, I believe. And then when they put that underground in Fairfax, put that huge tunnel in there, the flooding stopped in Fairfax, because every time it rained, they flood. But ours is a different story. Ours is a situation where you cannot separate it. It's all the same thing. If you remember right, in the 80s, MSD told us, You cannot put your downspouts into the sewer system. So MSD paid plumbers, believe it or not, $5,000 for each home. And they said, put it out in the street. So they made everybody put it out in the street. And when they did that, it flooded the sewer system because part of that flow was going into the sanitary system, which is going to the same spot. So not discounting this last one, we have issues that I think Norwood should be considered in the near future. But this last one, I don't care what you did, you couldn't have stopped that. You just couldn't stop it. So, had my say on the 68 degree.
Well stated.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor.
Did you have a comment over there, ma'am?
Deb is.
Did you? Oh, okay. I thought you had your hand up.
Any other questions on this topic before we move on?
You had said that the pipes going underground here are like 8 inches. In new communities, what size are they there?
Typical for a separate sewer system.
Mm-hmm. Or not either.
Well, we don't build combined sewers anymore. Mm-hmm. So the only way, I mean, the EPA wouldn't even issue a permit to install them anymore in a new development. It'd have to be separate sewers. So from MSD standards, the smallest sanitary sewer that you start with is an 8-inch diameter pipe. Typically, the building sewers coming from the houses are 6 inches in diameter on private property, and they can be typically a 4 underneath the slab of the house. But they come out of 6-inch, and typically if it's starting what we would call a head-end manhole, where that's right at the beginning, that's going to be an 8-inch diameter pipe minimum. Storm sewers are very different because they're based, if we're sizing sanitary sewers, we're looking at, frankly, how many people are in an average house? How much water are they going to use every day? And that number's actually been going down with low flow fixtures and other water conservation efforts. They're going to put all that through. We're going to do some peaking factors to decide what's the most flow they're likely to see. And we're going to include some allowance in there for some water's going to get in from the storm system through joints or whatever. It's going to be relatively minimal for new sewers, but it's still accounted. So it's not at all unusual in a new subdivision for you to see primarily just 8 and 12 inch diameter sanitary sewers. Obviously bigger as you get further downstream and there's more houses contributing. Storm sewers, very different, because it's going to be based on how much area is tributary to that, the streets, the roads, all this sort of thing. New development, if you come in and you build something in a new area, there's going to be regulations that are going to make it so that stormwater runoff from that is essentially equivalent to what it was before the development. And that's done with a series of stormwater control measures and detention ponds, retention ponds, other sort of green infrastructure these days. But it's sort of the Buddhist approach to sewer management, or above all else, don't make it worse. So it's designed that after you develop, and it's pretty much the same. But even then, some of those pipes can get very, very large coming out of these. So as a relative frame, typically you're not going to see a storm sewer. You're certainly not going to see them in an 8-inch. Generally, a 12-inch is going to be kind of the minimum, and then pretty rapidly, they're going to pick up in size. So where coming out of a subdivision, you may still have a 12-inch sanitary sewer. You may have a 24, 27, or 30-inch diameter storm sewer. And the difference in the amount of flow that can be conveyed through those, it's not, you know, directly proportional to the diameter, since it's based on area. So a 27 or a 30-inch diameter pipe takes a lot of water through it. So it gives you some frame of reference overall when you start talking about these things that are 20 to 14 feet wide. Say something, Pat?
Slope as well. The slope of the sewer. I mean, an 8-inch sewer at 1% is going to take less than an 8-inch sewer at 4 or 5%. So if your community's relatively flat, then, you know, the sewer's going to be following the grade of the community. So that all that comes into play when you design the storm and the sanitary sewers. But even design standards now, the storm sewers are only designed for a 10-year storm, and they look at a 25-year hydraulic grade line. And but this storm that we got in August was much higher than that. It would overwhelm new standards. No one designs to that size storm. You just physically can't afford it.
Which leaves us in an uncomfortable situation, though, because we're seeing much higher precipitation. And, independent of the politics behind climate change and all that and what you believe is behind it, I think the data is very clear. And just here locally, over the past 10 years, we've seen dramatic increases in the volume and intensity of precipitation. And there doesn't seem to be any reversal in that coming soon. So I think moving forward, this is one of the prime areas as a community we really need to be talking about, because areas like Norwood and some others that are, pretty tightly developed, there's not a lot of green space there. There's not a ton of new development going on, but we have to be looking at some of these opportunities of how can we actually mitigate some of the stormwater runoff coming into our sewer systems, because frankly, we just can't replace it all to make it big enough. So it's going to be a very, very challenging piece for all of us moving forward and doing that in a way that our communities can afford.
So that is where like retention ponds and things of that nature would come into play as far as the
green infrastructure
and slowly release the
green infrastructure. Sometimes you see planning changes where you have pervious pavements for developments where, some level of water is getting into the aquifer, things like that, or we're trying to alleviate some of our overflows with package plants per se that activate at the overflow and disinfect and screen. We've got large projects going on right now that help with that, and at least it gets the public health part of the water controlled, which is two components. There's volume and then there's public health. So that helps in that regard.
I think there probably will be a few more questions here, but if you would like to go to the next part of your presentation,
sure.
Feel free to go ahead.
So sort of changing gears on a quasi-related topic, obviously, we want to give a little bit of an update on the overall claims process and just some stats kind of where we are. Again, I would preface this in saying, it's unprecedented for us. The sewer backup, previously known as the Water and Basement Program, has been in effect since January 1st, 2004. We've never seen anything remotely like this event. Nothing. I mean, a quarter of it was the biggest that we've ever had before. So it sounds weaselly, but it's the fact of the matter. We don't staff to be able to handle this volume of work. If we did, we would have people standing around all day long every day, which obviously we cannot do. So where are we at right now? Well, we've been creating this as we go along and refining as we go along. And I mean, I think the reality is despite a lot of people working really, really hard from this on day one, it has not been the smoothest road. Hindsight is certainly 2020, and I think if we could transport back in time to then, we would do things differently. Things have changed since August 28th. This is the process that we're actually following right now. So for anybody that is actually filing a claim now, this is what they should expect. So when people want to file a claim overall for this event, they have a couple options still. They either mail it to us, they fill out one of the claim forms, which we have some of the extras here. They either mail it in or they drop it off physically to our facility out on Galbraith Road. We don't have an online submittal piece for this. Obviously, there's no real time frame associated with that other than customers have to submit a claim from within 2 years of when the loss occurred. One of the things that I will point out that is important and is different as this process has evolved, when we first started, we were really telling people in the public meetings, and we were really telling them, if you want to go ahead and do multiple claims, go ahead and do that so we can try and get you some portion of the money up front. Well, I think as well-intentioned as that was, it hasn't worked so well. So what we're finding now is people still can do that, but we really encourage them, if they have not submitted a claim already, to gather everything together and submit it as one. Because the way this is actually working, it could actually work to delay payment on some of their claims if they do it. So I'll come back to that a couple times, but it is a change that's important to note. Once we get it, that sort of starts our internal process. We have staff that are actually scanning these things in. Some of these are very large documents, all photos, logging everything and putting it into our system. They're turning them around fast, though. Again, these are people that normally don't do this type of work, but we've had some people, some of whom are actually in the room, who have really stepped up in this process and really extended themselves to work long hours and work really hard on this stuff. And frankly, I don't think they're getting enough thanks for what they're doing. They're scanning this stuff in and getting it attached. Once we have it, we have to take a look at these claims. And we're doing what we would call a technical evaluation or a technical screening. Some of the claims that we get in, people, we haven't even heard from them before. We have no report of a backup at that property. Some we do, a lot we do, some we don't. So again, recognizing the reality of the situation, when this all started, if you were in what we were calling internally the disaster zone, which corresponded to that big purple blob where it rained really hard and there was essentially combined sewers, we were doing a very quick review to try and decide whether or not we should offer cleaning services. And we tried, frankly, to err on the side of the customer if we weren't sure. If we thought it was reasonable that they may have had a backup or have had flooding that got into their building that it contained sewage from an overflow, we would recommend it for cleaning. So now when we get a claim from them, though, we have to take a look at it. If we've never received anything from them before, we have to take an initial look at it. If we did have a report of a backup there, we'd take a little more time on there and make sure where did this, we think this came from. Typically, this process is going to take from 1 to 7 days, depending on if it's, you know, one that was clearly established up front or if this is a brand new one. The longer end of that may be if we've never been out there, we have to actually go out in the field, do an investigation, shoot elevations, do some dye testing. There's all sorts of stuff that we may have to do. In general, it's on the shorter end of that. So coming out of that process, what we're trying to decide on here really is, do we believe that there was a sewer backup at this location? Was it overland flooding mixed with sewage? Was it just overland flooding, or was it some combination of these? If we believe that there was either a sewer backup or overland flooding that entered the building that probably contained sewage, we're suggesting through this evaluation to settle the claim. If through this process we can only come up with the conclusion that what was reported really had nothing to do with the MSD-owned infrastructure, we would recommend to deny the claim. So that's the first main split in the road. Assuming that that process actually came up with a recommendation to settle, it's already scanned in and we're simply marking that as that we're going to settle, which makes it so logged so that it actually is sent to our third-party claims adjuster. This was one of the big departures overall that we did not have on August 28th. Normally, we have such a small volume of these in a year that, frankly, our existing staff, it's a side duty that they do. Fortunately, this is not a big time sink normally. Clearly, we're in a different ballgame. If we did this with our own existing staffing, this would go on for years and years. We brought in a third-party claims adjuster to do this, so we did it through a emergency procurement through the City of Cincinnati processes. This did not follow the normal sort of RFP process, which would take in itself months and months to spec it, advertise it, bid it, evaluate, and come up with a contract. That was not done. This was emergency procurement. So ultimately, we reached out to try and find different companies that did this type of work, did some essentially sort of phone interview type of things with them, evaluated what they can do, and chose a vendor, and we did it under emergency procurement. So it's not the normal process. What's important to understand about that, though, is it means that we didn't have the normal process of performance standards in there. We don't have it in a contract with the third-party adjuster that we're using in TENCO to say, thou shalt, upon receipt, regardless of how many you have to turn this around in 4 or 5 days. We don't have that. So essentially, we're working with them to try and get them to ramp up, and frankly, they've been trying very hard to bring in different additional adjusters to speed up this process of adjustments. But it's important for people to understand we do not have a contract legal mechanism to force them to do more than they can do. It's not there. When they referred these, they actually issued them to professional claims adjusters. These are people that primarily normally work with insurance companies. This is what they do. So they look at the documentation that was submitted through the claims process. Hopefully the documentation was good. Hopefully people actually submitted some information about whether or not they have insurance, which any of you saw in some of the community meetings, we beat this like a dead horse. But it's still, there's problems there. Because of Ohio law, if people have insurance to cover little losses, they have to use that first before there can be any sort of settlement processed. So if they don't have that, if they haven't gone due diligence to actually do that to demonstrate that they've tried, it really slows down the process. So at any rate, these people are working through this process. They're looking at everything submitted. They're valuing the losses that were on there. They're weeding out what should be included and what should not be included based on the scope legally of the program as we are currently defined. The legal scope of what should be and should not be included as losses is established by a legal team from both Hamilton County and the City of Cincinnati, have provided guidance that the adjusters from TENCO, which is the third-party adjuster, use. Again, this has morphed a bit as it's gone along, and it's refined as the process has gone on, which makes it difficult, for understandably, for some people, because they may have heard a different message early on in the process. But legal refinement has come on and changed some of those parameters. Once TENCO and the third party, as the third party adjuster, reaches a what they believe is a proposed equitable settlement based on the legal parameters that have been established, they provide documents back to MSD. MSD has a legal review team that has actually been supplemented recently because these are starting to turn around quicker. So these are the lawyers. Only a lawyer representing the City of Cincinnati can actually enter into a settlement on behalf of MSD. And this is just one of the quirks of the way we're set up in our overall governance, with the city as the management agent for MSD and Hamilton County as the owner of the utility. So the solicitor's office can actually act in entering into settlements on behalf of the city, on behalf of the Metropolitan Sewer District. The third-party adjusters cannot do this. This is one of the things that people, I think, struggle with in understanding a little bit, because these aren't adjusters working for an insurance company that can come and say, this is, you know, back and forth, and this is what I'm going to give you. It doesn't work that way. So the third-party adjuster is providing a recommendation back to MSD. MSD is actually reviewing this legally, settling on some amount. Settling is probably not the right choice of words there. They're determining a final offer to be made to the customer to settle and release their claim. That is actually mailed formally to the customer. The customer at that point has an option to either accept it or refuse it as presented to them. But they are getting a formal settlement offer, which includes a legal release along with it. So here's our sort of second crossroads, main crossroads in the process. The customer is under no obligation, certainly, to accept the settlement as proposed. If they refuse it, they don't accept what's being presented to them, they have a couple of paths available to them. Again, another fork in the road. There's a sewer backup, a federal sewer backup program magistrate that was established in the federal court system. So through this, customers can actually take this information to this magistrate and sort of, it's not exactly, I'm not a lawyer, so take this for what it's worth, but this is not, it's like not like a normal court proceeding. A magistrate is acting as sort of a binding decider, it's kind of like an arbitrator almost. It's probably, if there were lawyers or if there are any lawyers here, you're probably hating me right now, but it's something kind of like that. This is something that some people can do through the SBU program, or they can choose to go through normal court processes in the state of Ohio if they're unhappy with the settlement. If there's some sort of little thing on here that was just missed in it originally and they have additional information, generally, you know, there's still some room for our legal team to work with them on trying to work that out. They would certainly rather do that than go through any of these other processes. On the other hand, if the customer actually accepts the settlement, signs the release that's been provided to him, they send it back to us. Once we receive that, one thing I will stress here, because I've been reminded to stress this, we don't have a checkbook sitting at the offices at MSD. We can't just pull out the checkbook and write a claim, even though all the paperwork's in place. We have to actually request a check that goes through the City of Cincinnati process on there, and it has to be cut. There's some processes in place to try and expedite that, but people have to understand they can't show up with their signed release and expect to walk away with a check. It will not happen. We'll try and expedite the process, and hopefully they will have that check cut and in their hands within 7 days, give or take, if they accepted the settlement overall. Any questions on the process overall before we move on to some of the stats?
Just real quick, if you mentioned the two-year window of filing a claim from the date, but if somebody filed a claim even now, or how would you determine, well, I know you said you'd come out and look, but I mean, how would you determine that what damage was caused, what was in the facility at the time that the claim was made? I mean, it just seems the longer you wait to file a claim, that
it gets much more
least
difficult.
You have less of an opportunity to get it settled because there's no, you still don't have physical proof that all this stuff took place.
You make an excellent point, and this is exactly why, even though people technically have longer, we'd strongly encourage them to do this as quickly as they possibly can. Mm-hmm. And to consolidate anything that they plan to claim. Because frankly, it's going to be easier to process all this stuff, and if it's easier to process some of the stuff, then it's easier to get them paid more quickly. Mm-hmm. The longer it goes on, the more challenging it can get, even if it's a completely valid claim.
The other question too, you mentioned that if you have your own personal homeowner's insurance, that is your primary source for the claim first. And then if they don't cover everything on it, then that would be looked at by MSD, or if MSD says, well, your insurance didn't cover it, we're not covering it either, or it's not part of our, I don't know how.
The primary, the legal requirement is that if you have insurance, you have to use that first, mm-hmm. or you have to attempt to use it first. So obviously, depending on your carrier and the riders on your policies and all this sort of thing, it can get complicated from case to case. So some people certainly have homeowners. Most people that have a mortgage have homeowners insurance. Mm-hmm. Many people that have homeowners insurance don't have sewer backup coverage. And it's certainly in an area like this, which is not next to a body of water, having flood insurance is not all that common. But that's where we still need people to actually, at that point, go to their insurance agent and produce, if nothing else, just a letter from their agent saying, I confirm that this person does not have coverage for the losses. It doesn't mean that MSD is not going to provide any coverage. It doesn't mean that we will. It means that they have to do that step in order to be evaluated. And if they don't, it's going to be a big log jam in the process. If they do have insurance for some of it, and it's a something that would, you know, we can readily say was associated with a sewer backup inside of a building, a lot of people are still going to have a limit. Say they had a $5,000 limit, but their damage was $10,000. Well, that's where we can then help to cover the difference on there, again, as long as the losses are associated with the backup, mm-hmm. and it's going to be based on the current value of most of those materials for personal property. So there's a lot of caveats involved in this stuff, which is clearly why I'm not an insurance adjuster. Mm-hmm. But we will still consider anything anybody submits. We just have to have them show whether or not they have insurance. And even if they do have insurance, if they have a deductible, if it's a loss that is associated with the sewer system, maybe they had $4,000 damage, they had a $5,000 limit, but they had a $500 deductible, then we can help to cover the deductible in those sort of cases.
So right now, if somebody filed something and they claim that they lost all their record albums in the basement and their couches and this and that, but by the, if they submitted that now, unless they have some very substantial photographs or something to prove that that stuff was actually down there and was floating around,
right.
You know, you'd send an adjuster out there now and he would have, or she, the adjuster, would have no idea what truly was there and what was damaged at this point in time. So just.
And this is certainly where we're relying on people to provide the best available documentation that they have, itemized lists of the things, and all that can be considered even if they don't have current receipts. One of the important things for people to understand, though, is if it's a covered loss, the amount of coverage depends on what it is. Early on in this process on here, and we talked about this a little bit, it's a fine line but a very important one at some of the public meetings. If you had a water heater or a mechanical system, water heater, electrical work, you know, an HVAC unit, an average life for a water heater, give or take, is going to be about 10 years. Sometimes more, sometimes less. If your water heater was 10 years old, but it was working perfectly fine, essentially we're going to try and compensate, and it was a loss associated with the backup, we're going to try and cover you for the cost of a comparable replacement new unit, not a depreciated value of that water heater, because the depreciated value of that water heater may be next to nothing mm-hmm. if it was 10 years old. If it was still heating water for you, it worked. So for those types of home mechanical systems, we're trying to cover you to get you back kind of where you were. Personal property is a different story. If you had a collection of albums, I have a bunch of albums in my basement, actually. I haven't listened to any in a while, but I have a bunch of them. If you go onto Craigslist or eBay or whatever and look at the cost of a 33 and a third RPM, it's not much.
Hmm.
And so it's going to be based on the replacement value of a comparable aged item for personal property. That's a really tough sell for a lot of people, and we understand that completely. You have sentimental value to personal items. The replacement cost of buying a 50-year-old wedding dress on Craigslist is not the same as getting your grandmother's 50-year-old wedding dress. But that's the way the process actually works on there. So there's a bright line between sort of mechanical systems and personal property.
I guess kind of following up on that, I think it's a great question. So, like, there's a gentleman here in the audience that was on Ellesmere, and he had just, like, some hot rod parts, I guess, in his basement. He is a connoisseur of that, and I'm sure we all know how cool some of those hot rod cars look when they're completed, but... he had some of his parts in the basement, and so some of these parts, again, they're for a 30-year-old vehicle or 40-year-old, could be older. So for him, when he submits his claim, he's worried that he's not going to be able to get, be able to replace those parts at the, whatever, at the price that he could replace, knowing they're 30 years old. So should he expect that, he has it itemized? Should he expect that he should be able to get a the offer that he might get from MSD or the whatever the appropriate amount should be, should that be enough to allow him to replace those hot rod items that knowing that he's going to buy 30 or he's going to buy that same type stuff?
I mean, obviously I can't answer that specifically, but as a general concept, that would fall under the personal property type of thing. So if the parts were damaged to where they're they have to be disposed of, then you come back to that question again of how much would it cost me to buy this part on essentially the open market? And in our world right now, the open market essentially is eBay, Craigslist type of thing. So I think trying to price something based on that sort of pricing model should be fine.
Okay, and then he would just provide that documentation to you, or
yes.
Do you all do that work for him?
Yeah, not to me personally, but through the claim process. Okay. Documentation. I think anything showing, that can make it easier to show the current market value of that from that sort of market economy sort of thing is really going to help expedite the process.
That's what the adjusters are going to do. They're going to, look for a, an electric heater or something from an old Ford, and they're gonna Google those parts and look for them. If the homeowner knows where to get those parts and says, "Look, I've researched this, parts available here," it gives the adjuster some place to start.
Mm. Okay, great. Thank you.
Obviously, there's a wide range of stuff in people's houses, and these adjusters, if they have any experience, they've seen a lot of stuff, but chances are you're going to throw something at them that they've never seen before. So the more documentation you can provide, the better.
Yeah. I mean, if before you throw something away, you need to prove that you have it. If it's a baseball card collection, it'd be very difficult to say you had a Honus Wagner card that you threw away because it was wet. Well, let's see the card. And there are some people that have some extremely expensive personal property out there. So yeah, whatever can be provided helps out.
Okay, that helps. Thank you.
Okay, so just as a high overview on this, so this is sort of current as of give or take today. So we've received 888 claims associated with that event, and we're doing this in parallel to receiving claims from previous events. We had some other, they sort of pale in comparison, but we had some very intense localized thunderstorms in a couple other parts of the district this summer, one a month to date earlier than this one, so we continue to deal with those as well, but that's not reflected in this. So these are just from the August 28th event. So we've received 888. They continue to come in on a daily basis, and we start the process of scanning them and starting them through the process. The technical screening commit has been completed on those of 779. Of that 779 in the technical screening, remember the first fork in the road, we're going to come out of that with either a recommendation to settle or deny the claim. Out of that 779 that have been done so far, two have been recommended to be denied. Everything else has moved forward in the process, which means, if you do the math, that 777 of those have been moved on to the third party adjuster in Tenco. So, of the ones that have actually been moved on to the adjuster, they currently hold 530 right now. They continue to add on different additional adjusters and allocate with the goal of trying to get these back. Our director has been very adamant with them within the constraints of what we can do legally, but he would like them to turn around at close to 100 a week. And so they're working very diligently at this point. But again, understand that that's great to set the goals in place, but that depends on the quality of what was actually submitted to them and, you know, how quickly they can actually move forward on some of these. 163 of those have been turned around recently, and they're back in MSD's court to look at the documents that were produced by Tenco. Because again, MSD, the legal counsel for MSD, is the only one that can actually finalize the documents and sign to send them out to customers and say, here's your offer. So there's 163 in that process right now being reviewed. 46 of them are in a status where they're out there essentially in the customer's court, letting them to decide, am I going to accept or refuse this? 15 of those other ones have come back from customers where they accepted them and a check's been requested, and 23 have been paid and closed. So obviously you can see sort of where the bell curve is on this overall in the process. It's moving faster. It's still not moving certainly as fast as we would like. Again, our director has made that very adamant and very clear overall that he wants all this to move as quickly as possible, and I think we all do. The process is speeding up. It's getting better, but I still think right now the best thing we can do is two parts. For anybody that hasn't filed a claim yet, document, document, document. Because the more you provide up front, the easier it's going to be. And number two, even though you can actually submit in separate claims, in general, it's going to behoove you in the timing submit it as one claim if possible. Even if it delays your first one by a couple of weeks, in the long run, you're probably going to get a check back quicker. So those are very important messages overall for people to understand.
Do you have a set date for getting everything done?
No. No.
This may be a better question. Is so for everything that's received so far, like that 530 that's at Tenco, what is their estimation for those 530 that they're going to be able to get through all of those? That's currently there, you know.
Yeah.
Nothing that's come after that. But
that's what we're shooting for, 100 a week. So theoretically, you know, you're in the range again, understanding that we've got this other log that we're working through right now. We haven't, there's another 100, give or take, that are waiting to refer to them once they complete that technical review, which 1 to 7 days. And then we continue to feed the machine on a daily basis. So they come in literally in a stack every day. So for the ones that they currently have, the expectation I think would be somewhere, you know, middle of January, we would hope that they would be somewhat through those. That's aspirational. It depends on the quality of what's been submitted to them. Could be shorter, could be longer.
So the 888 that has been submitted so far, that is inclusive of Norwood, St. Bernard, Cincinnati, everybody.
Yeah, that's not broken out by any particular area. As a point of reference, we have, as far as reported sewer backups and flooding incidents, we had about, initially reported back then, we have about 2,800.
Wow.
So of those, now that includes some duplicates, granted, where people will report it multiple times. But in general, it's just a shade over 2,000 that we actually confirmed as initially that we thought there was enough evidence to indicate that we should proceed in authorizing a cleaning of the property. It's a little over 2,000. So we also know all those at that point we would expect, not all of them, but a high percentage of those ultimately we think will probably get some sort of claim. Not all. But we also know we're getting claims from people that we have never heard from prior to submitting the claim. So we're still projecting somewhere around in the range of, we think we're going to process about 2,000 claims through this before all is said and done. Could be more, could be less.
So with that initially reported 2,800 number, do you know about what percentage of that was the city of Norwood versus others? And it does, I mean, it can be very rough. You don't need to, I'm not going to.
I can pull the number for you, but honestly, I would just be completely making it up on the spot right now. I don't want to do that.
Excellent. Yeah, that would be great.
We have a map we can show you. It shows some of the data as well.
Yeah, let's see that.
So this is, let me zoom out here a little bit. So we're still within the corporate limits of the city of Norwood. And obviously this is very difficult to see at this scale overall. But the important thing I think to understand is the stars on there are essentially sort of where we had confirmed that this was eligible for cleaning services. So that's going to be a good indication of the neighborhood. So if we zoom in a little bit on here. Up to the north, you can see where those areas are. Again, this is almost exclusively combined sewers up in here. And you will note some trends as you look along here. It's a little difficult to see on here, but you can see this sewer running in red. The sewers are in red, by the way. And it's difficult to see, but they have little arrows on sort of point the direction. This is going to be an older sort of easement sewer that was installed, was probably a creek originally before this neighborhood was developed. And what you'll see along some of these trunks that take the neighborhood sewers that tie into this, you'll tend to see more backups associated along the trunks. So farther up, closer to the ends of the system, not as much. This is where you tend to see more capacity problems.
That fuchsia line is kind of the ridge of the drainage basins. So you can see, wasn't nearly as much along the ridge.
Yeah, so as we get down into here, we obviously know there was a lot of rain in Norwood Lateral. There were cars submerged on there, but it's kind of down low there. So, not so much residential.
Would that have been from backups from the drainage, or was that like overland, just kind of,
it's hard to say exactly.
Okay.
Yeah. At some point Pat's an old stormwater guy on here.
Sewers in the highway aren't designed to that level of storm either. So it also depends, in August, you're not going to get a lot of leaves, but this time of year, if you get a lot of leaves, but if there happened to be some debris or something that, clogged an inlet, it'll pond very quickly.
At some point, though, the spacing of the inlets is even designed in a stormwater system of how much the overland flow is going to be and how frequently the inlets need to be just to get the water into the pipe. So at some point, there's more water on the surface than can even get into the inlets, and you start to have water building up on the roads and all that sort of issue. Sometimes, even if there is capacity still in the pipe, it just can't get in quick enough through the inlet structures. And that changes throughout the rain event, obviously, too.
Sure.
So, but you can see as we move down, again, as Pat said, on the sort of ridge line here, everything going over the Duck Creek watershed over here, and then this is all primarily going to the Ross Run and the Mill Creek. So here's some great examples, again, where you can sort of see. Here's the main trunk sewer coming down through this, and you'll note, not surprisingly, not a lot of backups in some of these residential areas and sort of the local neighborhoods, but along that path that is the one of the main arteries, more backups. Same thing over on this side where they're essentially following this. This is sort of classic symptoms of what you'd see in an overloaded combined sewer. And it also happens to rub salt in the wound. If you look just at the lay of the land, where those combined trunk sewers are, tend to be where the creek was, which happens to be sort of the lowest area. So any water that didn't even get into the pipes is still coming to that area because it's the natural drainage way. You can't fool Mother Nature, so the water still comes to that point. So these people, in many cases, are going to get a double whammy, where they may actually have a backup from the combined system, and they may also be flooded from overland flow that can't even get into the pipes. And you can see along here, down on Duck Creek at the very bottom end of this, this is one of the CSO locations, and this sort of pentagon here. So again, big pipe coming along on there. Natural drainage way where Duck Creek essentially was piped in, and it what was a natural water course.
So that, you know, we're looking at the CSO, the hexagon there. That, of course, was activated, I'm guessing. And so did that cause water? I mean, I'm not super familiar with exactly where that is, but where would that be actually? Like, where would the water that comes out of that go? Like, where is it draining to? Is it just draining to the street right there?
No, and this particular one, I think as the mayor mentioned, you know, this has evolved a little bit over time. You know, with some of the projects that the Corps has done and some of the highway projects and everything, this is more, it's not exposed. I mean, you can't actually drive and see it. This is actually piped in right now and continues on away before it actually ultimately discharges into the sort of the head end of what we think now is the Duck Creek Channel. And more of that's been enclosed now through the work that was actually done in Fairfax and everything, where some of that used to be open is enclosed. But there are areas that where it comes in and out through here where you would actually see it.
So you're saying that CSO, though, at Williams and Duck Creek there, there's nothing there. You're saying if I were to go over there and look for it, I would never find it because it's underground.
Right,
yeah.
So then when the water comes out, I mean, where does it, is there like...
It's ultimately discharging into the Duck Creek Channel, the concrete channel that you can actually see.
The CSO is just upstream of what we call the outfall. Generally, the other pictures were an outfall. You know, the CSO was really close to that. This one just happens to be further up in the system.
Okay. So you're saying there's a channel that's maybe similar to the Mill Creek channel?
No, it's a sewer.
It just, we can't see it because it's under.
Well, there's an enclosed pipe that then ultimately discharges into the channel, the open channel, which is the Duck Creek concrete channel, and similar to what you see in the portions of the Mill Creek that are channelized.
Okay. And so this pipe normally would never have sewage, like, I mean, it doesn't rain, there's no sewage that goes in it.
Correct.
Okay.
Yeah, this is sort of one of our operating permits for a CSO. Dry weather overflows from CSOs are strictly prohibited.
Sure.
So in general, I mean, that's where we have monitors at these things, and we spend a lot of time maintaining these diversion structures and grates and everything for that very reason, to make sure that we don't have any dry weather overflows. In wet weather, they're supposed to overflow. That's what they were designed to do. But the capital projects through Project Groundwork and the big consent decree projects are inherently designed to cut that volume down further. Or, as Pat said, to provide, in some cases, to actually put a treatment facility there at that outfall to do primary treatment. But that's contrary to the desire to actually remove water more quickly from the neighborhoods to get it to these overflow structures. So we're at sort of competing interests.
Excellent. Do you have any additional questions at this point? Okay. So we're starting to run close to 7. Again, I don't really want to go past 7. But I would like to have you all come back. I mean, we may not need the whole crew if you don't think so, but I really appreciate y'all being here. I know, I'm sure you all have families and stuff to be home with. So I'll just say, I definitely would like to learn more about what MSD might be doing in the future then to reduce the amount of water that's actually going into the system.
Yeah.
And before we go, real quick, you can be sure that that CSO, that none of the water coming from that CSO affected those Duck Creek residents. Like, that went into a channel and it never, well, what affected the residents was the backup before it got to the CSO.
Well, the people down on Duck Creek may be in a different story. Because this is piped in there, it's possible on for them that that pipe may have been running close to full. Up in the system further on, this is more localized flooding. It wasn't backwater from the CSO all the way. If you'd have seen backwater from the CSO affecting these people, you would have seen a lot more backups in this whole area here and up these local sewers. That is the best example there of why this had nothing to do with them.
Could be those houses are just, they're set down lower on one side of the street. You know, there's all kinds of things that can cause it.
But the water, I just wanted to make sure that the water that got into their places was much more, it was likely that it's before it got to the CSO point, not after. It wasn't like the water was flowing out.
That didn't come out of the CSO and come back and flood their properties overland.
Okay, excellent. So, but yeah, like I said, we do want to have you all come back. And I'd really like to learn, I mean, you know, I talked to you on the phone about the consent decree. I would be curious if there are any projects that would affect Norwood at all as part of that consent decree, if maybe we could talk, just learn about those, even if they're in 2025. I mean, it'd be
well, nice to and think. I think one of the important parts here is moving forward, you know, we're moving into negotiating phase two of the consent decree. So obviously, MSD's in a bit of an odd situation here coming up at the end of the 68 agreement. And the only thing I think that's guaranteed for sure at this point is something is going to change in the overall governance structure of MSD. I think it's very important, this is me, I think it's very important for the member communities that are part of MSD to take a very active part in those discussions about the future of MSD and be actively engaged in what's actually happening in phase two of the consent decree. Because in my personal opinion, I think we need to be looking at how do we allocate money to actually helping to reduce CSO volumes by also attenuating the local flow so that it helps backups as we have these more frequent rains. That can have an effect though on local policies, development, zoning, all these types of issues that require real involvement from the local communities. So this is where we really need you at the table as active members moving forward. I don't know what the governance is going to be, but hopefully you all want to move forward as more of a partnership on there and actually helping to frame and develop solutions instead of us just telling you what we're going to do.
Sure. Yeah, excellent. Appreciate that. Is there any additional things?
They're just kind of staring at the thing. All the stars are reported claims to date on there, or just
those are confirmed cleanings, not claims.
Gotcha.
Okay.
Yeah. Gotcha.
So this is where somebody reported a backup, and again, Grant, we were moving at light speed at that time, but you know, we did enough evaluation to say we think we should clean
we'll
this
get
property.
In and clean it and take care. Yeah. Okay. Perfect sense.
What if they turned your offer down to clean? Like, what if they said, okay, I already had somebody come down. Are they still a star or are they not a star at that point?
That's a good question. I'm not sure on that one, honestly, because I forget how we ran the data for some of these.
I think some, in order to expedite, I think in some areas they told them, yes, you need to get it clean. You can either wait for us to come and do it, or you can hire somebody, you know, a cleaning service
to absolutely.
Do it and
then
submit.
Think of how we ran it, but I remember now, and the data set. So essentially the stars are going to be, in order to get a star, which is kind of ironic, you would have had to have actually reported that you had a backup. And then from that, if we said, yes, we believe that this may have been associated with the sewer system, you get a star, independent of whether or not you actually accept the offer to clean. So some of these stars are going to be people who hired their own cleaner.
Yep.
Or said, I'm going to clean it myself, leave me alone, you've done enough. And some of these people are going to be people that actually accepted the offer to have MSD cleaners come in.
Okay. I do have a question. Are there other communities where their systems come through ours? Where their water or their sewer comes through Norwood?
No. No, it's a little bit unique because you're sort of centralized there and sort of on the ridge, so yours goes certainly through adjoining communities, but nobody's goes through yours.
You said water. Are you talking about drinking water?
Or? No. Okay. No. I was talking about the sewers.
Excellent. So, yeah, I'll definitely be in contact with you all. And like I said, we'd love to schedule another meeting. But I just want to thank everybody for being here, and Deb for helping to get this organized. Mike, I mean, thank you again for reaching out. And just for everybody else that was here, including the residents. So thanks again for being here.
Thank you. We'll leave some of these cards that if someone has detailed questions and they want to submit those, there's information on how to do that.
Can we get a copy of your PowerPoint?
Yeah, absolutely. And let me jump to this last one. I got a little something.
Yeah, please. Yeah.
So, because a few people would kill me if I didn't put this slide up publicly.
Yeah, we're not trying to run you out. Yeah. No, I mean just whatever.
No. So just things to know for people who are actually interested in if they would they're dissatisfied with the offers that came on there. They don't want to accept it. They want to go through the SBU ombudsman. This is the telephone number for the ombudsman. This is actually posted on our website, but just so it's to have it here in one place. If people have questions about their specific claim or the overall process, they can call the sort of the MSD claims question hotline number. Again, we have a lot of people that are really pulling double duty on this to their outside their normal jobs to cover a lot of this stuff, so we really appreciate that. But 513-244-5100, and they can get good information there. There's tons of information on our website, including all things SBU. And if anybody has any other things that they see that is not on there that they think is lacking, we would love to get the feedback, because we're constantly trying to refine that at this point and make it better and more user-friendly. There's a lot of information, so it's hard to make it where it's real accessible.
Excellent. Yeah. Is there anything else you'd like to share before we...
No, we appreciate the opportunity to come and talk to you about it. I think it's important for our customers to understand on there, we don't get paid for not trying to help people. We don't get a kickback or anything on here. There's no incentive for us to try not to help people. I understand this can be very frustrating with people. I understand that the process has not always worked as well as I think as we hoped it would. But I want people to understand in general, you can hate me if you want to, but understand there's a whole bunch of people at MSD that are really working their butts off to try and do the right thing here and to make it better for the future. And if they want to ask me about that, I'm happy to talk to them about it. If they don't believe that, I'll try and convince them otherwise. So we thank you for the opportunity to come and talk about it.
Excellent. Thank you all very much.
Thank you.
Excellent. And so with that, we'll close the committee meeting. Thank you very much.